Malachi chapter number 3. And then I want to call your attention to Matthew 2. And we will commence our discussion. This whole month we've been in the book of Malachi because it's very significant in that it marks the end of the Old Testament, but more importantly, it marks the beginning of a period of silence where for 400 years God will not speak to Israel again. And so part of the argument that we've kind of raised over the course of these past 4 weeks is that when God decides to shut up for a while, it behooves us to hold on to what he has said, to remember his instructions, his impartations, and the like. We've entitled this series, if you will, The Savior Who Sits, because he starts by saying, I'm going to send Jesus, and when he comes, he's going to sit amongst you. He's going to purify you so that your praises will be acceptable to me, and that I need for you to return to me because you've left me. I thought that was interesting that the God who says he'll never leave us nor forsake us says it is possible for me to be with you, but you to leave me. I think so many of us have the testimony that at some point in our lives we have left God. Isaiah says all we like sheep have gone astray. So what I want to read, and I won't read this whole thing for the sake of time, but I want to begin reading at verse number 8, and I'm going to read it for fluff. Everything that I really want to say is in verse 10 and 11, but I'll start with the whole context. The word of the Lord says, will a man rob God? You have robbed me, but you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings, you are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there would be food in my house. Then try me in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessings that there will not be room enough to receive. And I will rebuke the devourer. Here's the text. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, so that he will not destroy the fruit of your ground, nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. And verse 12 says, and all nations will call you blessed, for you will be a delightful land, says the Lord of hosts. Go to Matthew chapter 2 very quickly. And this really is not a textbook sermon, if you will. I'll be jumping back and forth between the texts, but you know, God didn't call me to preach sermons. He called me to preach messages. Verse number 11, I'll start at verse 9, I'm sorry, of Matthew 2. Here we deal with the wise men who have been led by a star first to Jerusalem to find the new king of the Jews. The problem is where the star rested was over the house of the guy that was about to be replaced. Some of you have been kicking yourselves because you saw the false before you saw the real. But God had to lead you to what was not so that he could show you what he has for you does not look like. You'll catch that later. He had to lead you to the fake, even though the fake had the seat and the crown. Y'all should probably leave Steve Harvey alone, because he just set the platform for some major preaching around the world. Because just because they got the seat and the crown don't mean they the real one. Lord have mercy. Some of y'all been kicking yourselves, but you would not be as wise as you are. You would not know what you know had you not met Herod before you met Jesus. So the star rests over his palace. God led them there. God led wise men to a fake king. Oh, Lord, have mercy. I wish I had time to preach that. Sometimes I just wish the Lord would give me what I want to preach. So he leads them, and they go and they ask, and they say, where is he that is the be born king of the Jews? And the text says that Herod has no idea, so he calls his wise men. And when his wise men come around him, they tell him, oh, well, he'll be born in Bethlehem. And, of course, the rest of the story goes this way. It says in verse 7, says, and when Herod had secretly called the wise men, determined from them what time the star appeared, and he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search carefully for the young child, and when you have found him, bring back word to me that I may come and worship him also. When they heard the king, they departed, and behold, the star which they had seen in the east went before them till it came and stood over the young child, or where the young child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. I'm in the text now. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother and fell down and worshiped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Then, listen to this, being divinely warned in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed for their country another way. Now, I need for y'all not to shut down on me, because I'm going to deal with something that most of us don't want to deal with, especially the last month, the year. I'm using the tithe to really approach another subject that's more important than money. All right? So here's what I want to talk to y'all about. I want to tell y'all that the devil's plan for you will not work. I know it's not a good topic. I know it's not really. But whatever the devil has planned for you, it will not work. Touch somebody beside you and say, it ain't gonna work. Father, thank you for this time we have to share. Thank you for the word from which we share on this last Sunday of this year of 2015. We have so much to be thankful for. You've kept us. You've blessed us. And for that, we say thank you. Now, allow me to preach your word. Anoint me to share with your people your heart and reveal to them your mind. And any way you bless us, we will be satisfied. It is in the name of Jesus we pray. And we boldly declare the devil is defeated. God, you are exalted. And Jesus, you are Lord. And all who agreed with the prayer of the man of God said, hallelujah. Amen. Amen. And thank you, Jesus. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord, and please give him a hand clap of praise in anticipation for a word. The devil's plan will not work. Good morning, family. My brothers and my sisters, Psalm 103, verses 1 through 5. It's a psalm of King David, and it is an exhortation to praise God. In this song of praise, Mama, David says, and I quote, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. I wanted to start this little discussion this morning with the recitation of this psalm because the writer makes it clear that the inspiration and impetus for praise ought to be the knowledge of the benefits that come with having relationship with and being loved and chosen by God. So that when you read Psalm 103, 1 through 5, he's saying the reason that you ought to praise God is because God has been good to you. And he lists benefits. Somebody ought to shout benefits. He lists benefits that ought to inspire you, that ought to move you, that ought to encourage you, that ought to incite you to praise God. I found to be interesting is that the word benefit comes from the Latin word benefactum. Bene, Latin for good, factum, Latin for deed, which literally means that we praise God because of the good deeds that he has extended towards us. And I thought it to be further interesting, Delia, that on this list of benefits that ought to be the reason for our praise, material things is the last thing to be mentioned. That when you go down through Psalm 103, 1 through 5, listen to what he says. The first reason you ought to praise God is because he has forgiven all of your iniquities. That he is the God who sees you and knows your track record and knows what you've done. But he looks beyond your faults and he sees your need for salvation. And since we're in this season where we are thanking God or should be thanking God for Jesus, we ought to understand that the first and greatest benefit is though I've been jacked up, he saved me anyway. Then he goes on. He says, not only should you praise him because he has forgiven your iniquities, but he heals you of all of your diseases, which means there's some stuff that medicine can't take care of. There's some stuff that you can't get a prescription for, treatment for, to get rid of. I wish I had a few witnesses in here. I believe if I give the microphone to Wanda and give the microphone to Charlize and give the microphone to Miranda, they will tell you that the bouts with cancer, watch this, were only treated by man, but the ultimate healer is God. Is there anybody in here besides me who can say, thank God for doctors, but at the end of the day, the best thing the doctor did was treat it, some symptoms that I had. But if I don't have what I had anymore, it is not because somebody has a medical degree. The reason I'm healed is because he is the Lord my God who heals me. Is there anybody besides me who knows what it's like to be healed by God? Is there anybody in here who knows that one touch from his hand can do what no doctor, no surgeon, or anyone else, somebody ought to shout, yes, Lord. The third thing he says is that he redeems my life from destruction. In other words, while I was on a path of destruction, a path that should have taken me out of here, a path that should have taken me down. In other words, I should be dead right now. As a matter of fact, I've been in some situations that
death was imminent and sure. But I praise him, watch this, because he redeemed me or snatched me out of harm's way and did not allow the death angel to take my life. Now, some of y'all too cool, some of y'all too calm, some of y'all looking for something that's deeper than this, but I need a few folk in here who knows that you should have been dead, but you're still here. I need a few people who understand that when you look back over your life, it does not make any sense that you are still standing, living, and breathing. Is there anybody besides me who has the testimony that he has delivered my soul from destruction? Then he says, watch this. He says, he crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies. In other words, he gives me a crown, watch this, of something that I really didn't deserve. That he's been better to me than I've been to myself, and most certainly than I've been to him. Is there anybody in here who could take this mic and preach the rest of this message and look at your life and declare and decree that he has crowned my life with loving kindness and tender mercies? As a matter of fact, this is my real testimony. Every time I look around, God keeps blessing me, and the blessings that I have and the blessings that I've received and the tender mercies I'm experiencing, I did not earn and I sure don't deserve. Is there anybody on this last Sunday of December who will be real in the house of God and declare that all of the good things that have ever happened to me, I did not deserve? If I'm talking to you, you ought to wave at me and tell me to go ahead and preach. As big a fool as I've been, as big a mess as I've made, as much stuff as I found myself in, as much trouble as I got myself into, God keeps being kind to me. Shout yes. Then he begins to talk about the things. Somebody ought to shout the things. The last thing he mentions are things that are material. The truth of the matter is, Elder Greer, there are things that are more important than things. As a matter of fact, true blessings that we receive are spiritual and not material. Ephesians 1 and 3 declares, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us, watch this, with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ. My brothers and my sisters, I needed to lay this platform because as we deal with the issues of tithing and giving offerings and all of these things that we'll progress to talk about, here is what you need to understand, that if you give tithes and if you give offerings simply to receive stuff, you are shortchanging yourself. You can get money without tithing. You can get stuff without giving offerings. We got at least 95% of the folk in here who can tell the truth and say, there's some stuff that I've gotten in my own power when I didn't give God a dime of what I had. Am I talking to anybody in here besides me who gonna get real? All right, y'all, I'm sorry. I'm at the wrong church. Let me go down the street and preach to the Hispanics because maybe they'll give me a better response than the people of God are giving me in here. I said there got to be somebody besides me who has the testimony that there have been times that I bought stuff, I got things, and I had not given God what belonged to him. Am I talking to anybody in here who gonna get real? Everybody in here ain't been faithful with your tithe, but look, you still got clothes on. Everybody in here ain't been faithful with your offering, but you got a roof over your head, you got food to eat. The truth is, the fact that you got stuff ain't proof that you blessed. There are things that are more important than things. If then, Tommy, there are more important things than that which is material, why does God place such an emphasis on giving? If material things are not the most important things, why is God dealing with us about giving what we have? Good question, ain't it? I'd like to suggest to you that there are three answers to this one question. First of all, God places an emphasis on giving because what we give is an expression of how we feel about Him. What we give is an expression of how we feel about the one who has been beneficent towards us. That is to say, that the appreciation for the tangible is always expressed in, or for the intangible is always expressed in tangible ways. And appreciation for that which is spiritual is always expressed in natural ways. Because we cannot give God the intangibles of life, health, and strength, because if God needed life, He wouldn't come to us to get it. If God needed health, He wouldn't come to us to get it. If God needed strength, He wouldn't look to us to get it. And because we cannot give God protection, because if God needed somebody to protect Him, He wouldn't call Kevin Long. Oh, Lord have mercy. Because God does not need forgiveness, because He is perfect. Perfect and holy, and if He did need forgiveness, He sure wouldn't come to none of us who are as jacked up as we can be. Because we can't give God the things, the intangible things that He gives us, watch this, my brothers and sisters, He accepts and expects concrete expressions of gratitude from us. In other words, oh God, I knew it was going to get quiet in here, but we'll shout in a minute. Since I can't give God what He gives me, He says, I need for you to give me what you can give me. You can't give me health because I'm Jehovah Rapha, the healer. Oh God. You can't give me peace because I'm Jehovah Shalom, the God of peace. Lord have mercy. You can't give me protection, God have mercy, because I am Jehovah Rohi, the good shepherd. But what you can give me, I wish I had a witness, is what you have in your hand. Watch this. And what you have in your hand is an expression of how you really feel about me. So God places an emphasis on giving, watch this, y'all, because He accepts and He expects concrete expressions of gratitude. You ain't got to believe me. 1 Corinthians 9:11, listen what the Apostle Paul asked. He asked a question. He says, now if we have sown spiritual seed among you, is it too much that we reap material harvest from you? Minister Barnes, the traceable biblical pattern of blessing, watch this, is on this wise. It happens that when we are blessed by God, we turn around and bless God. Y'all missed it. When God blesses us, the proper response is to turn around and bless Him. All right, y'all act like y'all ain't with me, but I'm gonna go further. Here's the equation. In Genesis 14 and 20, y'all remember, Abraham goes to rescue his nephew Lot, and he takes 300 servants with him. And they defeat over 40,000 men. Abraham and 300 defeat the other kings and 40,000 in the Valley of the Kings. Watch this. And the response that Abraham gives is he gives God a tithe of all. Now, is Abraham giving the tithe? I'm going to preach whether y'all want me to or not. Because of all the stuff he got. Or is he giving God the tithe because he looks at the odds? It's me and 300 of my boys against the enemy and 40,000 of their boys. And it don't make no sense that me and 300 ought to be able to whip 40,000. Y'all miss what I said. When you look back over your life, you got to have at least one testimony that some victories that you've won didn't make no sense. Am I preaching to anybody in here besides me who can look back over your life and say, I don't see how in the world I got out
out of that one. If I'm talking to you, you ought to wave at me and tell me, go ahead and preach. If my back was up against the wall, I was over the barrel, I was under the gun, I was behind the eight ball, but God stepped in and gave me grace that helped me to win. Shout yes.
So first of all, here's why God places an emphasis on your 10%. Because literally, watch this. He helped you to win battles that you know you shouldn't have won. Number two, God places an emphasis on giving. I love this next one, Saret, because giving helps us to grow and develop in his nature and character. Consider the fact that God's thesis statement about mankind is in Genesis 1 and 26, where he says, come, let us make man in our image and our own likeness. That is to say that we are to be the visible expression of what God is like. I thought it to be interesting that the crux of the gospel is enveloped in John 3 and 16. You know it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Come on. That should not but have. When we get, watch this. It's very interesting that when we give that which is valuable and to and for the cause of the kingdom, there is a greater dimension of blessing that is experienced. The question must be asked then, what is God like? According to John 3 and 16, God is a giver. And when you give, you become more like him. Oh, I'm gonna preach whether y'all want me to or not. I just busted somebody's bubble because you thought that the more Bible you read, the more you became like God. You thought that if you talked in tongues, sang in the music ministry, preached in the pulpit, that you're more like God. You thought that if you had a gift of prophecy and understood all mysteries, you were more like God. Well, according to John 3:16, God is a giver. And if you want to develop in the nature and the character of God, you need to set your heart and your mind to give as God has given. For God so loved the world, watch this, that he gave his only begotten son. I'm gonna go deeper in here. So it was not like he had 12 sons to choose from. He said, one time I'm gonna wrap myself in flesh, and to prove how much I love them, I'm going to send my son. I'm gonna talk whether y'all want me to or not. See, your giving is an expression of how much you love whoever you give it to. And if you gotta go through stuff, and if you can comb through stuff to give people what you want them to have, then that don't mean that you love them. Some of us, even on last week, were giving these consolation gifts. You know what a consolation gift is. I'm going to give you something to shut you up. That's why some of y'all sitting there looking tight right now. You didn't want the socks. You didn't want the t-shirts or the underwear. You got enough blouses in your closet. Some of y'all said thank you, and the gift ain't gonna see the light of day until you take it to the Goodwill. But if you really want to show somebody how much you love them, you give them something that is valuable. I'm gonna preach until I get this out of me, because the truth of the matter is, when God gave his son to us, he gave us the best that he had. I wish somebody in here who was mature in your spirit could begin to give God praise. Watch this, because when he gave you his gift, he gave you the best that he had. Do I have at least 10 people in here who say, I didn't need to get nothing for Christmas? I already got what I needed. God gave me his son, and that was the best he had.
In Acts 20 and 35, this is what Paul says. Paul quotes a saying of the master that is not included in the Gospels. It's what I call a secret saying of Christ. Nowhere will you find this in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but listen to what Paul says. As the master said, it is more blessed to give than it is to receive. What is God like? God is a giver, and he gives for the purpose of sustaining that which he has ordained for the accomplishment and the fulfillment of his purpose. Thirdly, y'all, watch this. God places an emphasis on giving because obedience and willingness in giving sharpens our spiritual perceptivity. Here's what I mean by that. When we give, it produces a greater spiritual sensitivity and openness to God so that we have access to the plans, the moves, and the moods of God. Watch this. And we also have access to the plans, the moves, and the moods of the devil. Y'all miss what I said. When we give, watch this, it increases our spiritual perceptivity. God begins to show us things that we had not seen before. I can promise you, those of you who practice giving of any kind, when you give, when you are led by the Spirit, God shows you a need that the person that you give to don't necessarily have to tell you anything about. How many of you have had God to speak to you and just tell you to bless somebody and you did not even know what was going on in their life? How many of you have had somebody just walk up to you and say, God told me to bless you with this? Can I tell you that when you give, it creates in you a spiritual perceptivity, watch this, so that God can use you, direct you, and move you in the way that he told you. Have you ever wound up somewhere that you didn't even plan to be, but God led you in that place anyway? Have you ever just been in a place where God told you to give somebody encouragement, give them a word, give them comfort, give them direction, and that wasn't in your plan for the day? You ought to touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, when you give, God begins to open your eyes and open to your ears to what his plan is in your life. You ain't got to believe me. In Genesis 15, the Bible says that Abraham saw God's plan for his life after Abraham gave the tithe. Y'all remember what happened? The Bible says that God told Abraham, Abraham, listen, I know you've been wanting a son, but the first thing I want you to understand is that I am your shield and I am your reward. In other words, I'm going to protect you and I'm going to pay you. Abraham says, God, what about this son of mine? I don't have one. All I have is a servant. Notice what he says. I'm going to give you a son of your own body in your old age. In other words, I know it looks like it may be too late, but because you are a giver, Abram, I'm going to open your eyes to show you that it's never too late for me. I wish I had a few people in here who could give God some glory because he's shown you that it's never too late. Am I talking to anybody in here who's had the devil to try to convince you that your life was over, that you would not make it, that you would not become what God wants you to be? But because you are a giver, God speaks to you and tells you that no matter how late it is, God is still able. Shout yes.
He did it for Solomon in 2 Chronicles 5, 6, and 7.
Solomon gave, and God answered his prayer. And now let's look at the text, because in both of our texts, y'all, God reveals his plan to givers. And when we talked about Matthew chapter 2, let me help y'all out with this. Y'all remember what happened? The Bible says that these wise men came from the east, and they came to Herod's palace. When they came to Herod's palace, the text says, somebody shout, the text says, the text says that when they came to Herod's palace, they came to announce the birth of the new king. Herod didn't know anything about the king. Text says that he came into them and he said to them, well, y'all go find out where he is and bring back word to me that I may go and worship him. Malachi chapter 3 says something really interesting. It says that if you would bring the tithe into the storehouse, there would be meat in his house, that you can prove him, and he would open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you don't have room enough to receive. In Matthew chapter 2, I told y'all I was going to be jumping, but I'm going to get you where you need to be in a minute. In Matthew chapter number 2, the Bible says they worshiped and their treasures were open. In Malachi chapter 3, it says that when they gave, heaven was opened. I want somebody to please understand that in both of these texts, the enemy was trying to destroy the people of God. In Malachi chapter 3, the promise is that he would rebuke the devourer. Somebody ought to shout rebuke. A devourer is somebody or something that's trying to tear you down, trying to tear you up, trying to take from you, that has plans to dismantle your life and to destroy you and all that you have. But Malachi says that God said that if you would just release the tithe and give me the offering, I'm going to rebuke the devourer. Now, here's what's really interesting, y'all. The word rebuke means to cry out. Somebody ought to shout, cry out. In other words, here's what God said. Those of you who will practice biblical giving, every time the enemy tries to secretly sneak in on you, I'm going to cry out against him. I'm going to uncover everything that the devil is trying to do to destroy your life. I don't know who I'm preaching to in here today, but somebody is sick and tired of the devil sneaking up on you, trying to take everything you got. It seems like every time you find a place of peace, and every time you find a piece of joy, and every time you find a piece of rest, the devil comes in and steals it. But God told me, am I talking to any givers in here? God told me to prophetically declare at the end of this year that because you are a giver, he's getting ready to uncover everything that the enemy is trying to do to destroy you. Who am I preaching to? Who can feel in your spirit that God's getting ready to uncover what the enemy trying in your life? Shout yes, Lord.
He says, I'm going to rebuke the devourer for your sake. Somebody shout my sake. He's going to do it for you. He's going to do it for you. He does the same thing for the wise men. Remember what happens with the wise men. The wise men go, and they go with the instructions from Herod. Herod says to them, bring back word to me where the baby is so that I may go and worship him. But when they get to where he is and they give their treasures, the Bible says that God speaks to them and tells them to go back another way. The question has to be asked, why is he telling them to go back another way? I'm glad you asked. Because he understands that if they go back to Herod, Herod will kill them. Herod was a murderer. He killed his own family members to protect his own throne. Anybody that he thought was a threat to him, he would kill them. Now, here's what I thought was real interesting. The text says that he says, find him that I may worship him. He is masquerading as a worshiper, but he's really a murderer. So I told y'all there's some stuff that money can't buy. God told me to tell you in this season,
Everybody who's masquerading as a worshiper, but is really a murderer, he's getting ready to open your eyes to the plans that they have for you. I'm going to preach whether you want me to or not. Some of y'all been sitting on the fence about some people. Some of y'all been saying they cool, but something ain't right. God said every false worshiper and real murderer, I don't care how sweet they sound, I don't care how good they look, I don't care what they act like they got to offer, if they don't mean you no good, I'm pulling the covers off. Somebody ought to shout, yes, Lord.
Three things. I'm done, Jonathan. Three things. Watch this, JT. Three things I want to tell you, son. Number one, y'all, if you're a giver, God guarantees you three things. First thing he guarantees you is protection. Somebody else shout protection. Protection. I love this. This is your word to carry you into the new year. You might not shout now, but if you start practicing this, when you get around March, you're going to start looking back over your life and start giving God praise for the stuff. Watch this. That he opened your eyes to and that he did, watch this, to keep you protected. Somebody ought to shout protected. Listen to what he says in Malachi chapter 3. Y'all, I got to get out of here. But notice what he says. He says now, if you bring the tithe into the storehouse, that there be maybe food in my house. He says, just prove me and see if I'm not going to open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you won't have room enough to receive. In other words, I'm going to bless you. You're going to get the stuff, but the stuff ain't the issue. So notice what he says in verse 11. He said, and I will rebuke the devourer for your sake so that he will not destroy the fruit of your ground. In other words, God said, whatever you do, if you do it for my glory, God have mercy, I'm going to step in and protect it. Your problem is not a money problem. Your problem is a protection problem. I wish I had a witness. The enemy comes and devours what you have. Y'all miss what I said. Watch this, Tommy. He wouldn't be devouring nothing if you didn't have nothing. So the issue is not that you don't have it. The issue is that you can't keep it. But God said, watch this. If you are a giver, I'm going to step in. I wish I had a witness in here. And I'm going to be your personal protection service. That every time the enemy comes, I'm going to set off an alarm. Y'all know what CPI. You know how CPI is. Whenever a burglar comes to your house, if they don't know the code, if they enter in any way without a key, the alarm goes off and it notifies everybody around. You ought to touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, because I'm a giver, God has promised me to protect me and everything that I got. I came to preach to somebody in here to tell every giver, I don't care what went on at North Lake Mall, it wasn't your baby. And part of the reason that it wasn't your baby is because you have been protected. Shout yes. I wish you touch your neighbor. Say, neighbor, everything about you is protected. The devil is a lie. He can't get your family. He can't get your money. He can't get your mind. He can't get your stuff. Somebody ought to shout, yes, Lord. Number two, whatever that plan won't work because I have protection. I have guaranteed protection. Somebody shout, guaranteed protection. Guarantee protection. Number two, he guarantees me production. Somebody ought to shout production. Listen to what he says. Listen to what he says, and I got to get out of here. He says, nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field. He said, not only am I going to keep the devil from taking what you got, I'm going to keep the devil, watch this, from stopping what you start.
I know this is an elementary message. Come back New Year's Eve and we'll shout. But here's what he says. He says that whatever you do, it will come to pass. The enemy specializes on devouring what is and stopping what will be. He does not just mess with your present. He tries to mess with your future. But God said, and I'm only preaching to givers in here. God said the enemy will not be able to stop what it is I have begun in you. Come here for a minute, Herod. Help me to preach it. So you found out, I wish I had a witness, that the new king was in Bethlehem. You sent the wise men to find the baby. The wise men did not come back. What happened? I sent out a decree that every child 2 years and under should be murdered. Watch this. Two mistakes that the enemy made. Number one, he let Jesus get here. And number two, he killed the wrong ones. I wish I had a few people in here who can look over your life and say the reason that you were not miscarried or aborted was because you had purpose. Am I talking to anybody in here who has the testimony that when you look around and look at your life, the enemy got people around you, but he didn't get you? Somebody ought to lift your hand and give God praise, because he gave you the right and the power to produce. I wish you grab your neighbor and say, neighbor, I may not look like much, but as long as I'm here, there's a chance that I can produce everything that God has placed in me. And I can shout today because I'm protected, and I'm protected because God ain't through with me yet. Shout yes.
Guaranteed protection, guaranteed production. But here's the third thing, y'all. I'm going home. It ain't even 12 o'clock yet. Guaranteed protraction. Somebody ought to shout protraction. Listen to what he said. Listen to what he said. He said, you going to produce because I've protected you. I love this last part. He said, and all nations will call you blessed, for you will be a delightful land. Now, wait a minute, God. Because earlier you said that the whole nation was cursed with a curse. How are they going to call me blessed? And you just said I was cursed with a curse. Tell your neighbor, here's the answer. The answer is this. God said, when you give, I reverse every curse that you put yourself in line for because of your failure to give. You miss what I said. I'm going to help y'all to understand something that you probably wouldn't nobody tell you. The devil's bad, but he ain't got power to curse. I said he's bad, but he ain't got power to curse. Let me see if I can fix it. There's a man by the name of Balak who's been hired by a man by the name of Balaam to curse the people of God. They pay him money to curse Israel. He takes the money and looks them in the face and says, thank you for the money, but whoever God has blessed, no man can curse. So some of y'all who been losing sleep at night because you think somebody went to see some witch doctor, some fortune teller,
some soothsayer to mess your life up. Go home and go to sleep tonight, because I don't care what they do, how many candles they burn, how much the clairvoyant see, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. Somebody ought to shout, yes, Lord. Matter of fact, I'm speaking over your life right now. Every hex, every curse, every incantation, all the candle burning, all the goober dust spreading, all the looking into crystals that they've been doing to try to mess you up, the devil is a lie. Victory is yours. Touch three people, say, neighbor, it will not work. I feel like preaching. I feel like preaching now. I said I feel like preaching now. Let them go see who they want to see. Let them read their card. Let them read the stars. Let them open the horoscopes. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. Shout yes, Lord.
How about shaking? Oh God. I'm done. Watch this. He promises protraction. Somebody shout protraction. I asked the Holy Ghost, Fat, why protraction? And he took me back to 3 years ago when Donovan and I were over in the annex and we were boxing. And Donovan thinks, because I'm old, I still can't throw hands. But the older you get, the wiser you get. I may not be fast as I used to be, but I know how to pick my spots, pick my shots, and don't ever fight an old dude. Because the older a man gets, the bigger his hands get. And the bigger his hands get, the harder he hits. I hit Donovan so hard that I broke a bone in my hand. When I went to the doctor, watch this, I'm through dying. When I went to the doctor examined my hand and said, we're going to have to put your hand in traction. I said, in traction, doc, what do you mean? He says, well, I'm going to have to put your hand in a place that it is immobile, watch this, so that the bone could mend. He said, I'll have to straighten your hand out. I wish I had a witness. So that what is broken can be fixed. He says, if I don't straighten it out, I'm going to talk whether y'all want me to or not. It will never mend. Here is what God said to Malachi. Then I'm going to go back to Matthew and we're going to go on home. He says to Malachi, return to me. In other words, when you come back to me with the tithe, what it's going to do is it's going to make right what was wrong. And whatever was broken in your life, I'm going to turn around and fix it. All right, that ain't good enough for y'all. Come here for a minute, Matthew. What did the wise men hear? The Bible says that God spoke to them in a dream after they had opened up their treasures, and says when they opened the treasures up, that God divinely warned them that they should not go back to Herod, and they went back home another way. In other words, God gave them a path that would enable them to miss and bypass destruction. I came to preach to somebody in here today. I said I wasn't going to holler, but I feel the Holy Ghost now to let you know that if you will honor God with your substance, he'll make straight your path. Grab your neighbor and
and say, neighbor, I'm getting ready to give God praise because he promised me that he would guide me around my enemies. He promised me that he would keep me from all destruction. He promised me that when the enemy comes in like a flood, his spirit will raise up a standard against the enemy. Can I go higher? I came to tell somebody in here that if you give God what he asked you for, the Bible says that he will rebuke the devourer for your sake. I came to prophesy to 35 of y'all. Turn around is on its way. I came to talk to 37 of y'all and tell y'all that God getting ready to carve out a path that the enemy cannot follow. Shout yeah, shout yeah, shout yes. Come here, Moses. Help me to preach it. What did God do for you? He parted the Red Sea. And when the enemy tried to come behind me, he drowned the enemy up. I wish I had somebody in here who's ready for God to defeat every enemy that may come your way. Lift your hand. Open your mouth and shout, God, I trust you to protect me from my enemy. And if all I got to do is give you 10%, and all I got to do is trust you in all my ways, then I'll do it so that I can have victory like I've never had, blessing like I've never seen, favor like I've never known. Grab your neighbor, say, neighbor, oh neighbor, the devil is a lie. Whatever he planned, it will not work. Your mind is protected, your marriage is protected, your money is protected, your children, they're protected. Shout yeah, shout yeah, shout yeah, shout yeah, shout yeah, shout yeah. Y'all excuse me, but I'm covered by the blood. I'm covered by his power. The word declares that he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Touch your neighbor. Say, neighbor, you're covered. Touch another neighbor. Say, neighbor, you're covered. Tell yourself, say, self, I'm covered, I'm covered, I'm covered. Shout yeah, shout yeah, shout yeah, shout yeah, shout yeah.
Everybody who's not standing, please stand. Here's what I want to say to you. God has so much in store for you that money cannot buy. So he has to test you with money to see if you believe that he is your source and not money. The wise men opened their treasures and worshiped. And God began to divinely warn them that they should go another way. I've been in prayer all this week
And it's amazing how God will begin to show you what it is you need to do. What's not what it looks like or what it seems to be. Some of you are about to spring the enemy's trap. By a simple act of giving. I learned this a while ago. It's real interesting, Mary. Rats and mice are different. You see far more mice get caught by a trap than rats. Can I tell you why? Rats are smarter than mice. So let me tell you what happens. Rats like cheese. And so you set a rat trap with cheese. But here's what happens. When a rat goes to the cheese and the cheese is in the trap, he smells around it. And guess what he does? There's something in his whiskers that senses that it's danger. So he gets close enough to know that there's danger. And he triggers the trap, but he moves back. But he doesn't just walk away. Angie, I love this. You know what the rat that got away does? He pees around the trap. So that every other rat, when they smell the urine, know not to go close. Because wherever they smell the urine, there's a trap. The enemy said that he tried to trap many of y'all, especially concerning your finances. But today's message was a trap being sprung, and you won't have to go down the road of destruction because God has already spoiled and foiled the plans of the enemy. The trap has been sprung. I don't know who I'm talking to today. The enemy had planned so much for you. That's why the end of this year was the worst time of your life. But God said today, and I'm talking financially, but God said today, the trap has been sprung. The trap has been sprung. I'm going to do something a little different today. All of us who are here today, I want us to examine ourselves and to see if we've had the message of tithing and giving preached to us and we've rejected to respond to the command. And today, I'm not asking you for an extra offering. I'm just asking you for what's right. And today, if you believe the word of God, if you believe that he's going to protect, if you believe that he's going to cause you to be productive, and if you believe that he's going to cause you to be on a trajectory or a path of protraction, that you're going to move further in the right direction, that things are going to mend, that things are going to heal, I want you today, if you've been tithing, if you've been giving an offering, a biblical offering, a sacrificial offering, I want you to continue in it. But today, the last Sunday of this month, if you say, I have not this year been faithful to God in my giving, because I thought it was about just giving money and getting money,
I didn't know that there were spiritual blessings that were attached to it. And today, if you want to take God as one of the only challenges that he's ever issued, he said, prove me now with this principle. And Miss Willie may see if I won't open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you don't have room enough to receive. He said, try me. If you need an envelope, raise your hand. Text says that the wise men worshiped and they gave. Giving is an expression of worship. Please hear what I'm telling you today. Giving is an expression of worship. Lifting our hands is fine. It's acceptable. It's even encouraged. Opening our mouths and speaking words of gratitude, expressions of thankfulness to God. It's acceptable. It's even commanded. But the one area of worship that we fall short in is giving. But today, to set the course, a protracted course for 2016, in this year, in obedience to this command. And he said, I'm going to rebuke the devourer for your sake. And the testimony is that you will be a delightsome land. I wish I really had time to talk about the mystical principles of giving. God has a way of turning your credit report